My name is Joseph Peterson. I'm a associate professor of geology at the University of Wisconsin, Oshkosh. Paleontologists came out here to collect bones and put them in museums, but there wasn't a lot of scientific research being done with the collection process or looking at the context of the bones in the surrounding rock. And that's really what we're focusing on right now, is how does the geology and the paleontology come together to really reconstruct what happened at this site millions of years ago. When the Cleveland-Lloyd Dinosaur Quarry was being formed and deposited back in the Jurassic period, this area looked very, very different than it does today. Instead of it being a desert-like environment, it was a semi-arid floodplain. So there were a lot of rivers and ponds and lakes in the area, but it had some strong seasonality. So there would have been a monsoonal wet season and then a dry season. More like what we see today in East Africa. Most people that have done work in dinosaur paleontology have thrown their head in one form or another trying to figure out Cleveland Lloyd. Let's take a crack at it. And we found that this is a great outdoor classroom. So not only is it a world-class fossil locality, not only is it unique in being the most dense concentration of meat-eating dinosaurs in the world, but it's a phenomenal place to come back to every year with students to teach them field geology, field paleontology, and get them that hands-on experience. So we've been doing geochemical analysis, microfossil analysis, and general bone excavation and mapping at the quarry. So it's really is truly a world-class site beyond anything I've ever worked on before.
So context is key. Cleveland Lloyd in and of itself would just be a bone bed. We need to understand the entirety of the Morrison Formation in this area to find out which ways Cleveland Lloyd is similar and in which ways it's distinct, not just from other bone beds, but from the other rocks and environments represented by those rocks. And so this is sort of where our teaching laboratory concept comes into play. We need to understand the deposition around Cleveland Lloyd, which is preserved in the bluff behind it. The students need to learn to identify sedimentary environments and do stratigraphy. So they get to learn and we get some data.
Oh man, I mean, I could live here, definitely. It's a beautiful landscape. A lot of different features, different geomorphology that I'm learning about. The desert, you know, being in the desert, it's nice and warm. It's what I like, so. It's definitely a cool place to be.
I mean, it's really hard to beat. The outcrops are spectacular. There's a gorgeous variety of geology that you can look at here that we can get them to work with. And every day, at least a few of them come up and they just, oh, I've never done this before. It's so great. I finally understand or see this. I finally feel like I'm really doing geology. I really am a geologist. And that's what the goal of these sort of experiences are, is to take what they've heard in lecture and put their hands on it and really do that personal experimentation and learning with the rocks.
I think once you get out here, it's like you have to keep coming back. It's addicting. It's every day is something new, and you know, you get to see so many things and you're learning so much every single day. So it's really an invaluable experience to be out here. I think one of my favorite things to do, probably as tedious as it is mapping. So when you are mapping, you are starting to realize some of those patterns, orientations in the bone, or where things are more conglomerated than others. So I think that's really part of the cool part, because you're starting to realize in the field before you even get back to, you know, the lab and are looking at the data, you can kind of see some of those patterns start to emerge.
So we're going through the quarry in 10 to 15 centimeter levels, digging down a little bit more and a little bit more. And every time we get down to that level, we map our bones on a grid system. We then take the number of photographs to produce a photogrammetric model, as we call it. And then we'll have a 3D model in the computer of that level of excavation. And over the years, we can study how that deposit changes in depth.
And what we end up with is a living three-dimensional map where you can watch as we go in, as we uncover bones. So there's no question about where this bone came from, where that bone's orientation is relative to the bone next to it. It's really unprecedented in the history of the quarry. Now, this is the most careful expedition I've really ever been on, because we have such a large area of bone to work with, and we always have to be very careful with our footing. We're always watching where our feet are, because where one bone is, another bone pops right up, another bone pops next to that, and it's the only site in the world really where you can get frustrated when you find another bone, because they're just everywhere.
I just want to do something here that, you know, not many people have done before, something that's unique to the site. And the geochemical work out here has been very little, not much of it has been done. So it's a very good opportunity to collect more data, more evidence, and overall support the theory of what actually happened here. I'm looking for lead, arsenic, copper, more of the metals that are signatures of, I would say, death events, harsher environments. Now when we get influxes of those, we can correlate that to there's an influx of a death event here, an influx of a death event here. And when we do that, we can correlate to see if this was just a one-time death event or if this happened a number of times. And work our way from the bottom up and just take little sediment samples every 10 centimeters or so up. And we're gonna take those back to the lab in Indiana and test them and see if we can get any sort of readings of an increased concentration of heavy metals or maybe a decrease in concentration of heavy metals. And we can correlate that to it being more of a toxic environment or if it's stabilizing the environment over time. It could be these dinosaurs did not die here, but they were transported here. And if we can get any geochemical data on that, we can begin to see where they might have came from, if the dinosaurs themselves made this pond toxic, or this pond being toxic ultimately led to the dinosaurs dying here.
Coming out here last year, I brought a binder like this thick of all the different papers that had been published about the quarry and people who were doing work on the quarry and all these different theories that are trying to explain what's going on here. And I just pored over them because I was so interested how there could be so many different ideas about this one place.
Well, that's kind of the great part about what we've been doing in working up our hypothesis here is that we're really blending a lot of things together. We know that part of the process involved a drought assemblage, as has been hypothesized. Part of it involves the bloat and float idea in this ephemeral pond, and part of it does involve a certain amount of water toxicity. So we're finding evidence to link together a lot of old hypotheses. So we've primarily added in, at least for this initial hypothesis, two new types of data to understand what's going on at Cleveland-Lloyd. First, we're looking at what we call intermatrix bone fragments, and that just means little bone chips, sort of the size of these pebbles or sand grains, that were exposed at the surface through experiments, especially in Africa and the Serengeti. Other researchers have been able to watch how bone breaks apart at the surface. And so when we excavate the quarry, we can find these bone fragments and understand that they were exposed in a very dry, arid environment and effectively disintegrated into bits at the surface. And those are preserved with these perfect, beautiful specimens at Cleveland-Lloyd. So what that tells us is that Cleveland-Lloyd represents periods of both drought and flood. The drought creates the chips, the flood brings in these nice, perfect bones. What we've been able to add to that then is an analysis of the geochemistry and the metals present at the deposit, as well as some unusual mineral formations in and around the bones, to show us that when the environment was wet and flooded, all of these rotting dinosaur carcasses created sort of an awful soup. And that's uninviting for things like fish and turtles and crocodiles that would typically scavenge the bones. And so it helps us to understand why we don't see those types of organisms preserved here where we typically do in the Jurassic, and also why the bones here haven't been gnawed or chewed or crushed. And so by looking at it from more of a sedimentary and geochemical perspective rather than just, hey, Allosaurus, we get a bit more of an understanding and we can tie together and show how these previous hypotheses have all been right, but at the same time needed to come together to form a whole picture.